Why isn't innovation saving the planet? I quit my corporate career over 20 years ago to start a climate tech venture capital fund. You might think an idea before its time, but it was actually clear back then that climate change was the single greatest threat to humanity. The planet will actually survive, but many species, including our own, won't. I was really frustrated that the big corporations weren't doing enough to address the problem, and I thought, all we have to do is find the startups. They're inventing the solutions. They will put an end to climate change. That was my original hypothesis. Yet, here we are, two decades later. Not a day goes by that we're not confronted with the disastrous consequences of climate change. Deadly wildfires, scorching heat waves, devastating hurricanes, and unprecedented flooding. And that's just this past year. So I wonder, how is it that we can invent a vaccine in 1 year instead of 15 when the world is faced with a raging pandemic, but we can't invent the solutions for the single greatest threat to humanity? Let's take a step back. Climate change is caused by greenhouse gas emissions. CO2 makes up about 75%. So where do these greenhouse gases come from? Well, power generation from burning fossil fuels is the largest contributor to CO2 emissions. We all know the potential of solar and wind energy to replace fossil fuels. Yet, they only make up 12% of the energy mix, despite the fact that the first solar cell was created in 1883, and the first wind turbine was built in 1887. Now let's look at transportation. Transportation makes up a third of greenhouse gas emissions. The first electric car appeared in Germany in 1888. And the fuel cell, still a key technology behind the adoption of hydrogen, was invented in 1839. All of these technologies laid the foundation to putting an end to global warming. Yet here we are, almost 150 years later, with increasing global warming. Where did we go wrong? Well, it takes a lot more than just innovation to solve the climate crisis. Innovation might be the seed, but the seed will not flourish on barren land. Only 10% of startups actually survive. They have to overcome dozens of challenges. But in my experience, after the initial invention, it boils down to four key challenges, which are also the reasons why I think we have failed to date. The first challenge, we've got to get that seed of innovation to sprout, and that is validating the value proposition. Technology is a waste of time and money without the ability to actually create value. This process includes piloting numerous design iterations, achieving rigorous industry standards. And then there's the commercial part. Can they actually deliver the promised performance at a price that is acceptable to their customer? This is a phase of highest failure. It's actually quite exciting, but it's also really difficult. In our early years of venturing, we made some quite brave investments into wave energy. And our first investment was on this massive snake-like contraption that would convert wave energy into electricity. Sounded brilliant, and we actually managed to build 5 prototypes. But the source of the energy was the North Sea, and exactly the force of the North Sea proved too great for the contraption to actually survive. And because one wave disaster isn't enough, we had to make another one. And our second wave energy company built a device which is today, at best, a diver's attraction off the coast of Australia. My lesson learned was not many technologies are actually going to survive this first challenge. Let's go to the second challenge for the now validated technology, is to be taken out into the world by top talent. We're often mesmerized by the undying passion of entrepreneurs. But in industrial technology, passion isn't enough. Breaking into industrial markets is really hard. And startups need exactly the expertise and deep understanding of those industries they're planning on disrupting. We need climate quitters, those experts who leave their corporate jobs to pursue a career which will have a positive impact on the climate. Startups desperately need climate quitters in their teams. Now, as venture capitalists, of course, we love working with entrepreneurs, and their ridiculous optimism is very contagious. But we also have met some who are less successful. And I'm not going to name any names, but I would characterize them as follows. We've got the entrepreneur who absolutely refuses to accept any market feedback because it conflicts with their own conviction. And they take that conviction right to the startup graveyard. Then we've got the entrepreneur who vastly underestimates the challenges ahead, refuses to recruit a strong team, and they are the one-man show that never really takes off. And then we've got the entrepreneur who raises massive amounts of money based on misplaced euphoria and ridiculous projections, which they inevitably fail to deliver, and then they get themselves fired. So, let's just assume now we've cleared this talent hurdle. What's the next challenge? The third challenge is securing sufficient funding to fuel growth. The journey hasn't been exactly free up till now, but this is where it becomes really expensive. Scaling an industrial technology is a huge endeavor. We need massive amounts of money, and venture capital only provides the first part. We provide the part that gets them to an economically viable solution, which is then ready to scale. That pales compared to the amount of money that's needed to actually scale. Think of offshore wind turbines, solar parks, charging station networks. If we are to achieve net zero by 2050, the world has to invest at least an additional $1 trillion per year. Admittedly, that's a big number. But just last year, we spent $7 trillion subsidizing fossil fuels. So the capital does exist, yet many promising startups fail to scale due to lack of funding. A good example of an industry that actually managed to secure sufficient funding was the solar industry. Despite early innovations and inventions in the US and in Europe, it wasn't until later, when China plowed massive amounts of money into subsidies, that solar energy was able to achieve the economies of scale and true cost competitiveness. That maybe wasn't great news for our little solar company in Toledo, Ohio, but it was pivotal for the widespread adoption of solar energy. And China isn't the only country getting into the game. Across the globe, governments are coming up with programs to catalyze investments which will get us to, hopefully, net zero. Now, don't get me wrong, these programs are welcome. But still, the single greatest driver of capital remains purchase orders. Which brings us to the fourth, and I would say the greatest challenge, and that is market demand. We cannot just assume that markets are going to demand and adopt technologies because we desperately need them to. These industries have been in place for decades, and billions has been invested to create these machines of economic production, which have brought us economic progress. But they've also driven us to the desperate environmental situation that we're in today. Frankly, they would rather not change. Change is hard and painful, especially when it comes with a hefty price tag. A deep scar I earned from this lesson was when we invested in an automotive catalyst company over 10 years ago. The startup had developed a solution which cut car emissions by over 50% at no extra cost. A real no-brainer for any investor. Well, you can imagine how perplexed we were when the catalyst companies weren't jumping to adopt the technology, despite the fact that the car manufacturers had already validated the performance, and despite the fact that air pollution causes 7 million premature deaths per year. That's more than one person dying every 5 seconds. So what happened to our no-brainer investment? Well, we completely underestimated the power of the incumbents. The oligopoly dynamics, coupled with a lack of regulation, actually allowed them to block any innovation that threatened their cash cows. So tens of millions of dollars later, we wrote off our investment, shut down the startup company, and I not only lost a lot of money, but I also have to say I lost a little bit of faith in mankind when I had to admit that money does dictate behavior. And without regulation, some industries will never change. Too often the incumbents have little or no economic incentive to change, unless they have to. And therein lies the genesis of the tipping point. It has to be more expensive not to change. So when does this magical market demand tipping point occur? When three things happen. Number one, consumers start demanding more sustainable products. Number two, politicians pass regulation that forces them to change. And number three, investors start taking environmental impact into account. That gets the attention of the board of directors. And when their jobs are on the line, stuff happens. Just in the past 3 years, corporate climate commitments have increased tenfold. So if I were to guess which industries are going to reach this market demand tipping point next, after power generation and transportation, I would guess it's going to be plastics and the built environment. There are 150 million tons of plastic in the ocean today. That's a ratio of 1 to 3 to fish. The problem is not new, but not much happened until the general population started scrolling over pictures of the Great Pacific Garbage Patch and realized that plastics will outweigh fish by 2050. This got, of course, the attention of the politicians, and they stepped in with directives, which are like suggestions. And when that didn't work, regulation. I'm not exactly sure why they started with banning the plastic straw, but it's a start. I would say investors are not quite on board yet, but when it becomes too expensive to ignore, this industry will tip. The next industry is the built environment. Buildings account for 40% of CO2 emissions because of their very large energy demands. The challenge with buildings is that the ultimate owner rarely benefits from implementing energy-efficient technologies, and they're not held liable for the environmental decisions that are taken during the construction process. Building owners are not going to be making additional investments in adopting brand new technologies just so that their tenants can consume less energy and it can benefit the environment. Now, granted, consumers don't have a lot to say about how large buildings are built, but regulation does. And when it finally kicks in, investors will feel the pain as well. So going back to my original hypothesis, I wasn't completely wrong about innovation. It does have the potential to solve the climate crisis, but not without market demand. So where do you fit into this market demand dilemma? Well, you are the ultimate consumer choosing products, and you are the one who's electing those politicians. And even if you're not a stockbroker, pension funds own 40% of companies. That's your money that you could and should have a say in. Market demand is key. It fuels innovation, catalyzes validation, attracts those climate quitters, and ultimately unlocks financial resources. That is how technology innovation gets adopted at scale and creates a real impact. And that is how I believe we will solve the climate crisis, because you have the power to create market demand. Use your power to demand change, and use your power to save humanity. Thank you.